Hello and welcome. We are on page number 11 of chapter number 6, ITC. In the previous class, what we have done is, we have examined the statutory provisions relating to input tax credit dealt by section 16 of the CGST Act. Now what we will do is, we will try to analyze the provisions as contained in section 16 of the CGST Act as well as rule number 36 of the CGST rules. Now, what is the eligibility for taking input tax credit? As per section 16 subsection 1, registration is a must. Only a registered person shall be entitled to input tax credit of GST charged on input supply of goods and or services. However, this is not unrestricted, but it is restricted and is subject to provisions contained in section 49 and also the restrictions contained in the CGST rules. Now, what does section 49 of the CGST Act provide for? It provides for the provisions relating to payment of tax, interest, penalty and other amounts. Now, we will deal with section 49 in chapter 9 of our intermediate course. The next condition to be satisfied for availing ITC is that the input goods or services are to be used for business purposes. Only those goods and or services which are used in the course or furtherance of business will be allowed for as a ITC. Tax paid in respect of input goods and or services or capital goods which are used in the course or furtherance of business. What do you mean by business? We have defined in our previous chapters. Also, the definition of business was given in this chapter also. The intention to use the goods or services in the course or furtherance of business is also sufficient for availing the input tax credit on goods and or services. Now, these goods or services are to be used in the course or furtherance of business or intended to be used in the course or furtherance of business. So, the intention of using them in the course or furtherance of business is also sufficient in order to avail the ITC. Thereby, those input goods and services which are intended to be used for non-business purposes, that is, for not in the course or furtherance of business, are not eligible for ITC. Your ITC will be credited to your electronic credit ledger. You also have certain conditions for availing ITC under section 16 subsection 2. A person shall be, or a registered person shall be eligible to avail input tax credit only if the following conditions, which are prescribed under rule under section 16 subsection 2 read with rule 36 of the CGST rules, all these conditions are to be satisfied if you want to avail the input tax credit. What are the conditions? You should have a document on the basis of which you are eligible to claim the input tax credit. What are the documents which will enable you to avail the input tax credit? Invoice issued by the supplier, that is first one, or invoice issued by the recipient where the procurements are from unregistered suppliers, along with the proof of payment of tax in the case of reverse charge. So in reverse charge, what will happen is, if you are procuring from unregistered supplier, that fellow will not raise the invoice. The recipient has to raise the invoice. Also, the payment will be made by the payment of tax will be paid by the recipient in respect of a reverse charge. Now, if you are procuring from registered supplier, then the invoice will be raised by the registered supplier himself, but the payment of tax will be paid by the recipient. Now, this payment of tax proof is also to be kept by the person who is availing the input tax credit. Debit note issued by the supplier, bill of entry in respect of imports, because on imports for basic customs duty you will be paying basic customs duty is still there, but additional duties of customs which are there, some of them have been subsumed into the GST, right? So on imports you will be paying IGST. That IGST can be availed as input tax credit, but as a proof you should have the bill of entry. Where a revision of invoice is made, the revised invoice should be kept, and also document issued by the input service distributor. Now, so these documents, at least any of these documents are for certain types of input tax, certain documents are applicable. For certain types of inputs, certain types of documents are applicable. So whatever document is applicable in that ITC, you have to keep it as a proof, or you can claim only based upon those documents. Now, those documents based upon which you are availing the input tax credit, they should contain at least, of course, an invoice. What are the contents of the invoice have been specified separately. But if you want to, in order to make you eligible to claim input tax credit, at least certain items are to be mentioned in the document. What are those amounts? What are those specific minimum items which are to be specified in the document which are based upon which you are availing input tax credit? Amount of tax charge. What are the description of the goods? What is the value of supply? What is the GSTN of the recipient as well as the supplier? What is the place of supply if the supply happens to be an interstate supply? Section 16 of the CGST, Section 16 of the CGST Act and the CGST rules do not specify what copy of the invoice is eligible for taking ITC. But rule number 48 of the CGST rules specifies that the original copy is for the recipient of goods. So based on what document you have to avail input tax credit, original copy is to be kept on record as a proof for claim of ITC. Now, what is rule number 48? We will be discussing in our chapter number 8. Suppose any tax is paid towards a demand involving fraud, then on that tax that has been paid can't be claimed as input tax credit by virtue of rule 36 subrule 3. Suppose where any order has been passed by the GST authority and a demand has been confirmed. Now, this is on account of a fraud or a willful misstatement or a suppression of fact. In such cases, that tax which has been paid can't be taken as ITC. Another condition that is prescribed in clause B of subsection 2 of section 16 is that in order to avail the ITC, the goods must have been received. But there are certain cases wherein the goods are billed to somebody, but they are shipped to somebody on the direction of the recipient. Now this is called as a bill to ship to model. Now let us take an example as to how this bill to ship to model works. Bill to bill to ship to. Let us say A supplied goods to B. Okay. Now the value is 1 lakh and GST is 18,000. This works out to 1,18,000. Okay. So 1,18,000 is the value. Right. Now this 18,000, we can avail it as ITC, but one of the condition that is required to be satisfied is that the goods are received. Goods are received by B. Goods are received by B. Then only he can avail the input tax credit. Now, it may so happen that sometimes what A will do, there is one Mr. B. B entered into a contract with A for supply of 1000 units of raw material. Now what B say is, you deliver the goods to one Mr. C. You deliver the goods to one Mr. C. Now A will raise the invoice on B. Now the value of supply is 1 lakh. The GST is 18,000. Now whether this, in order to avail the credit of 18,000 by B, one of the condition prescribed is that the goods should have been received. Now are these goods of 1000 units reaching B? These goods never reached B. They were sent to C on a request made by B. Now the goods are received by C. Now in this case, B can avail the input tax credit. Now you may wonder as to why, the goods are required by B to be sent to C. There may be various reasons. This C may be a factory situated in another city or another city of another state. This may be a factory. Or what happened is, after the goods have been procured by B and the goods have still reached Mr. B, what happened is B got a order from C. So instead of A sending the goods to B and B again unloading and again loading and sending to C, is a waste of time and money. So what B has required A is to send the goods directly to C. Now A will raise invoice on B. B in turn will raise invoice on C. Okay. This may happen sometimes. Now in such a cases, 18,000 input tax credit will be, B is eligible to take this input tax credit even though the goods are not received by him, but they are sent to someone else on his direction. The same is with the case of services also. Right? Now a trader, let's take an illustration. A trader who places an order on B for a consignment of soda ash. A receives a buying order from C for the same quantity of soda ash. So what happened? A enters into contract with B, right? B is the supplier. A is the recipient. But what happened is C, A has received an order from C. So what A instructs B is to deliver the goods directly to C. So A never received the goods. But still A is eligible to take the input tax credit on the invoice of B. Okay. Now moving forward, we'll go to next example. The registered office of ABC Private Limited. So ABC Private Limited has a registered office at New Delhi. For repair and maintenance of computer system installed at its registered branch office in Bangalore, Karnataka. So in Karnataka, there is a branch office. Now this is the head office or registered office for that matter. Now, with whom they entered into a contract? DEF Private Limited. Now what DEF Private Limited has to do? It has to carry out the service at the branch office which is situated in Karnataka. Now what DEF Private Limited has done? It has issued an invoice in the name of ABC Private Limited. Now the services are received by whom? The branch office. So ITC will be allowed in the hands of the head office, because on the direction of this fellow has carried out the service. Okay. Now, tax levyable on supplies actually paid to the government. My dear friends, and filing of return. My dear friends, in the previous class, in respect of this point and this point, what has happened is I have explained to you that the supplier has to pay the tax and the supplier has to file the return of the return under section 39. But however, it is not that. What 16(2)(c) and what 16(2)(d) state is, the registered person who availed ITC, or in order to make him eligible to avail ITC, the tax should have been paid in cash or through ITC on the goods or services for which ITC is being taken. You are buying a product X. At the preceding point, you paid GST. If you want this as ITC, then there should also be output tax. Then only you are eligible to claim the ITC. Let us say you used this as a raw material in a product. Finished product is exempt. Can you take ITC? You can't take ITC. Now suppose you used this as a raw material, you got a finished good. Finished good is taxable. Then you can take input tax credit. So this provision in the previous class, at the time of referring to the provision per se under section 16, I explained to you that the tax should have been paid by the supplier. It is not that. Here, what the tax has to be paid by the supplier, that is there. But as far as what this section, subsection and clause provide is that the product on which or service on which you have availed input tax credit should actually be subjected to output tax also. And also the person who is availing the input tax credit should have filed the returns under section 39. Okay. Now, goods received in lots. It may happen sometimes that there is a single invoice, but the goods are received in a staggered manner. Then you will be eligible to take input tax credit on that invoice only on the receipt of a last lot. Let us understand this by way of an example. X enters into a contract with ABC for supply of 10 metric tons of a chemical. Now, the taxable value is 10 lakhs and the GST is 18, thereby the invoice value is 1,18,000. Now, what is the amount of ITC involved here? 18,000. Now, this XYZ Limited is eligible to claim this 18,000 as ITC is provided all the other conditions are satisfied. The chemical is to be delivered in lots over a period of 3 months. ABC raised the invoice in August itself. XYZ also made the payment in August itself. But the supply is completed in the month of November. Though the invoice is dated in August, though the payment has already been made in August, but the goods actually reached the ABC only in the month of November. Therefore, this fellow will be eligible to claim input tax credit only in the month of November. Okay. Payment for the invoice is to be made within a period of 30 days. Else, what will happen? Payment is to be made in the within 180 days. So, the registered person for his inwards on which he is going to avail the input tax credit, that fellow should make the payment within 180 days from the date of invoice. If he does not do so, what will happen? He has to add the input tax credit availed to his output tax liability and he should also pay interest from the date of availing credit till the date when the amount is added back to his output tax liability. So this fellow, one of the conditions that is now this fellow, what he has done, since he has not made the payment within 180 days, he has added the proportionate input tax credit available to his output tax liability. Now suppose after 180 days, let us say on the 200th day, he has made the payment, then again he can retake the input tax credit. However, the time limit of for payment within 180 days is not applicable for reverse charge supplies, deemed supplies without consideration, and addition to supplies on account of by way of penalty, late fees, etc. Now, here what will happen is, the in respect of deemed supplies where there is no consideration, also in respect of addition to the value of supply on account of late fee, penalty, etc., it is deemed, because for late fee, penalty, etc., the time of supply is when it is actually received. Okay. Next. We will understand this by way of an example. Due to a quality dispute, PZP Limited withheld the payment on machines supplied by the vendor till it could be rectified. Over 180 days went by this dispute. The credit taken by PZP on invoice is to be added to the output tax liability. It has to pay back the credit. When the vendor rectified the machine and PZP releases the payment, again PZP can take the credit. Okay. Now, I will explain this by way of an example. Now, let us say, on 1st of April 2020, A procured goods from B, taxable value is 1 lakh, The IGST is 18,000. Therefore, the invoice value is 1,18,000. Invoice value is 1,18,000. Since on 1/4/2020, all the conditions are satisfied, this fellow availed 18,000 as input tax credit. Availed 18,000 as input tax credit. Okay. Now, this has to be paid within 180 days. Let us say the 180 days will expire on 30th September 2020. Maybe a 1 or 2 days difference might be there. Let's take, for the sake of example, 180 days will expire on 30th September 2020. Right? Now, since this 1,18,000 was not paid, what this fellow has to do is, he has to add it to his output tax liability immediately on the expiry of the 180th day. So on the first, on 181st day, he has to add it to the output tax liability. Now suppose he has paid 50,000 and he did not pay the balance 68,000, then the reversal is to be made proportionately. The reversal is to be made proportionately. Right? Now what happened is, on 200th day, the payment is made. Previously, because payment was not paid, you added to the output tax liability. Now the payment is made. What you can do? You can retake. For retaking the input tax credit which was reversed earlier, there is no time limit. But for original ITC, there is a time limit. That is within September return date of next year or annual return date, whichever is annual date of filing of annual return, whichever is earlier. That we understood in the provision, as well as we are going to understand it in our analysis part also. Depreciation on a tax component. Now let us say you procured a plant and machinery which is a capital good. It is valued at 10 lakhs, the taxable value, on which you paid 1,80,000 as IGST. Now the total invoice is 11,80,000. If you want to claim this ITC on of 1,80,000, depreciation can be claimed only on 10 lakhs. If you are going to claim depreciation on 11,80,000, you are not going to get the ITC. So for this 1,80,000, you have to choose whether you want it as an ITC or you want to claim depreciation on 1,80,000. If you want to claim depreciation on 1,80,000, then you won't get ITC. If you take ITC of 1,80,000, you don't get a depreciation on 1,80,000, but you will get a depreciation only on 10 lakhs. Time limit for availing ITC. So within what time? Let us say an invoice is dated 1st of April 2019 to 31st March 2020. Your invoice date falls between this date. That is, let us say 1st of October 2019 is your invoice date. There is the 10,000 rupees and the GST is 1200, for example sake. Now this ITC, within what time you can avail? Because it may so sometime happen that you might have missed the invoice. Later on you could be able to trace it. Now what the provision section 16 subsection 4 state is, it can be availed any time till the due date of filing the return of for the month of September. What is that due date? 20th October. You can claim it before 20th October 2020 or date of filing annual return for financial year 2019-20 whichever is earlier. Because after filing the annual return, you will not be able to be in a position to modify that. So latest by 20th October, you should have claimed that. That is 20th October of 2020 is the last date by which you should have claimed that ITC. Now, this 16-4 time limit will not apply to the reavailing of credit that we already discussed just now in our preceding paragraph discussion. Somewhere here we have discussed. Here we have discussed at the reversal if payment is not made within 180 days. Okay, next, what is the example? Let us understand it by way of an understanding. By way of an example, Hercules Machinery delivered a machine to XYZ in January 2018. Invoice number is 49, dated 28th January 2018, for which 4,15,000 plus GST. And it undertook trial runs and calibration of the machine as per the requirement of XYZ. The amount chargeable for the post-delivery activities was covered in the debit note raised in April 2018 for 50,000 plus GST. XYZ did not file its annual return till October 2018. Now, when is the original invoice? Original invoice date is 28th of January 2018, means relating to the financial year 18-19. What is the date of debit note? Date of debit note is 1st of April 2018. Though the debit note is dated 1st of April 2018, this relates to an invoice of 18-19. So what you can do is, before 20th October 2019, before 20th October 2019, what you can do, you can avail the input tax credit. You can avail the input tax credit or data filing of the annual return. But here it has been given that annual return is not filed before or till October 2018. So 20th October 2019 is the last date for you to avail the input tax credit on 4,15,000 or on 50,000. Okay, next, restriction of ITC in proportion of taxable supplies to business purposes. This is dealt by section 17 subsection 1 and subsection 2. And ITC not allowed on certain supplies, dealt by section 17 subsection 5. We will discuss these items in a later part of our discussion. Now, what is this ITC in proportion of taxable supplies or business purposes? That we will understand with an example. Let us say X Limited has procured goods worth 10 lakhs. Goods worth 10 lakh on which 1,80,000 is paid by way of a GST. On which 1,80,000 was paid as GST and the total invoice is 11,80,000. Now, coming to the question of this 1,80,000 GST, whether this fellow can avail it as ITC is a question. This is a raw material. Now, with this raw material, this fellow is manufacturing two types of finished goods. Finished good 1 and finished good 2. Finished good 2 is exempt. Finished good 1 is taxable. Now, this fellow can't be in a position to take the entire 1,80,000 as input tax credit. He is eligible to take only proportionate ITC. He is eligible to take only proportionate ITC out of this 1,80,000, because this is a common input for both taxable as well as exempt. Taxable means here there will be again two types. One is taxable and also zero rated. Zero rated is also taxable, but taxable at a zero rate. Okay. So what are exempt supplies? We already learned the definition of exempt supplies. Or sometimes what will happen is this may be used for business purpose as well as personal purpose. So if it is used for business purpose, you will get the entire input tax rate. But if it is used both for business as well as personal use, then proportionate input credit as attributable to the personal use will be disallowed, and only the balance will be allowed to be availed as input tax credit. Now, how to calculate the amount of eligible ITC and what is the ineligible ITC computation procedure, we will deal in rules. Okay. Next, there is also a concept called as blocked credit. Means certain types of input tax credit you are not at all allowed, though the inputs are used for business, in the course or for furtherance of business. Even in such case also, you are not eligible to claim the input tax credit. So friends, we learned section 16, and also we went into the analysis part of section 16 and the relevant rules in relation to section 16. Now we will proceed to section 17 and the relevant rules for 17. Section 17 deals with the apportionment of ITC as well as the blocked credits. What we will do is, first we will learn the provision, or first we will go through the provision. Thereafter we will go through the relevant rules relating to this section 17. Thereafter we will go into our analysis part. Friends, this may be a bit confusing, but you may slowly understand the concept. You may not be in a position to understand this at a first instance itself. You have an opportunity to replay this video. So you may replay it for one, two or three times to get a better understanding. When you go through the provision per se, you may not be able to grasp the entire content or meaning at a go. But once when we go into our analysis part, you will appreciate this provision in a better manner. Now that we will start with section 17, subsection 1. First, just we will go through the provision as it is. Thereafter, we will go into our analysis part. Now, what does section 17, subsection 1 state? Section 17, subsection 1 state that where the goods or services are both are used by the registered person partly for business purpose, partly for other purpose, then the credit shall be restricted to the inputs as is attributable for business purpose only. Right? Where the goods or services are both are used by registered person for partly affecting taxable supplies, including zero rated supplies, means zero rated supplies are also considered to be taxable supplies under this act or under IGST, and partly for exempt supplies, then the amount of credit shall be restricted to so much of the input as is attributable to the said taxable supply, including zero rated supply. Just we understood this here by way of an example. Here what has happened, this input has been used for taxable supply as well as exempt supply. Now how much input credit that attributable to this portion allowed will be eligible for ITC and the tax attributable to this amount is not eligible for ITC. Same is the case with business or personal. Okay. Next. For the purpose of subsection 2, the exempt supplies will be as prescribed and include supplies on which the recipient is liable to pay tax on reverse charge, transactions in securities, sale of land, and subject to clause B of paragraph 5 of schedule 2, sale of building. So here what it has been said is, if it is used for taxable as well as exempt, then the GST is to be apportioned, and only that part of GST which is attributable to the taxable quantum will have to be availed as input tax credit. A registered person may be providing various supplies, so out of which some may be taxable, some may be exempt. Now, in what do you mean by exempt? Nil rated, which are exempt, which are also non-taxable, we learned, right? Here what they are saying is, they shall be notified, but you should also include those supplies on which tax is liable to be paid on reverse charge. That also is to be taken as exempt. And transactions in securities, exempt. Sale of land and subject to clause B of paragraph 5 of schedule 2, sale of building. These things also should be taken as exempt supplies for determining the proportion. Now, value of exempt supply shall not include the values of activities or transactions specified in schedule 3 except paragraph 5. A banking company or a financial institution, including a non-banking finance company, engaged in supplying of service by way of accepting deposits, loans or advances, and advancing of loans or extending loans or advances, shall have to pay the comply with the provisions of subsection 2 of or avail of every month an amount equal to 50% of the eligible ITC. So you can apportion, the banking company including NBFC can apportion the credit in this manner, or simply what they can do, they can take only 50% of the eligible credit. An option has been given to them. Okay, that provided an option one exercise shall not be withdrawn during the remaining part of the financial year. So at every financial year beginning itself, they have to decide, provided that this restriction of 50% will not apply to supplies made between one registered person to another registered person having the same plan. Means for a distinct person transactions, the restriction of 50% is not applicable. They can take in full. Notwithstanding anything, now coming to subsection 5, 17 subsection 5. This deals with blocked credits. Blocked credits. Friends, these are provisions per se as given in 17, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We will also go through the relevant rules. Thereafter, we will go into the analysis part. Just here, you have a bird's eye view of the provision. Right? Notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 1 of section 16 and subsection 1 of section 18, ITC is not available in respect of the following. So for these items, though you are utilizing them or the intended use is in course or furtherance of business, but still you are not eligible to avail the input tax credit. What are? There are certain points. Just we will breeze through these points. When it comes to the analysis part, we will discuss in detail. Motor vehicle for transportation of persons having approved seating capacity of not more than 13, including driver, except where they are used for making taxable supplies, namely further supply of motor vehicle, transportation of passengers, imparting training on driving such motor vehicles. So motor vehicles not having a seating capacity of more than 13 are not eligible for input tax credit. But if they are used for these purposes, they are eligible. Similarly, on vessels, aircrafts, no ITC can be availed. But if they are used for the following purposes, then ITC can be availed. A vessel is not eligible for input tax credit, but if it is used for transportation of goods, it is eligible. So, if that vessel or aircraft is used for making a taxable supply of further supply of vehicle, transportation of passengers, imparting training on navigating such vessels, imparting training of such vehicle, flying such aircraft, then you can avail input tax credit. Service of general insurance, servicing, repair and maintenance. In so far as they relate to motor vehicle, vessel or aircraft referred to in clause A or clause AA. So if any expenditure for service of general insurance, servicing, repair and maintenance of motor vehicle, vessel or aircraft, the GST on such items is not available for as input tax credit. However, input tax credit will be available where such motor vehicle are used for the purposes specified therein. Suppose the motor vehicle is used for further supply of motor vehicle, for transportation of passenger, for imparting training. Suppose this vehicle general insurance is made. So GST on such general insurance will be available as ITC. Right, where received by a taxable person engaged in the manufacture of such motor vehicle, vessel or aircraft, or in supply of general insurance service in respect of such motor vehicle, vessel or aircraft insured by him. We will understand in detail in our analysis part. The following goods, supply of goods or services or both, is not eligible for input tax credit. It is the blocked credit. Food, beverage, outdoor catering, beauty treatment, health service, cosmetic plastic surgery, leasing, renting, hiring of motor vehicles, vessels or aircrafts referred to in clause A or AA, except when used for the purposes specified therein. Except for purposes life insurance and health insurance. This is blocked credit. Now, if they are referred to in A and AA, if they are used for the specified purposes therein, then it is allowed. The input tax in respect of such goods or service or both shall be available where an inward supply of such good or service or both is used by a registered person for making an outward supply of the same category of goods or service or as an element of a taxable composite or mixed supply. Friends, just we will go through the provisions, then we will analyze it in our later part of our discussion. If you are making a membership payment for club or a health and a fitness center, not eligible. Travel benefits extended to employees on vacation, such as leave or home travel concession, not eligible. But ITC will be available where it is obligatory for an employer to provide the same to its employee under any law for time being in force. Works contract service when supplied for construction of an immovable property other than plant and machinery, except where it is an input service for further supply of works contract. Okay. Goods or service are both received by a taxable person for construction of an immovable property other than plant and machinery on his own account, including when such goods or service are both are used in the course or furtherance of business. So even it is for the course or furtherance of business also, that immovable property construction part you are not eligible for ITC. For the purpose of clause C and D, the expression construction includes reconstruction, renovation, addition, alteration, repair to the extent of capitalization to the said immovable property. Goods or services both on which tax has been paid under section 10, that is composition levy. So if you are paid, if you are procured from a composition dealer, you are not eligible for ITC. Goods or services both received by a non-resident taxable person, except on goods imported by them. Goods or services used for personal consumption. Goods lost, stolen, destroyed, written off, disposed of by way of a gift or a free samples. Then also input tax credit is not available. Any tax which has been paid under section 74, 129 and 130, it is also not available as input tax credit. So friends, we went through the provisions as contained in 17 subsection 5 blocked credit. We will understand in a better manner in our analysis part of it. When we analyze that, we will be in a position to understand in a better manner. Friends, we will continue in your next session.